Hi there YouTube, and welcome to this video where I will be explaining the FractTrade hyperparameter optimization process and how you can create your own file for strategy optimization. After you have watched this video, I hope you can make a simple hyperopt file to test your indicators and to find the optimal settings for them. I put a lot of effort in making these videos, so please click the like button and give me a comment if these videos help you with making your own profitable trading bot strategy. Also, please remember that this video is intended for entertainment and education purposes only. I am not pretending to be a professional, and all information you see in this video are my personal experiences and knowledge from the books and websites I read. Now, let's move ahead with my setup for this video. Again, I will make use of my Linux Mint virtual environment. And as usual, all configurations are on my GitHub page, so you can follow along with this video. If you want more specific information about strategy building, hyperparameter optimization, or the use of FractTrade as your self-hosted trading bot, please use the FractTrade site. This site is an excellent additional resource for this video. And if you want to see more examples of hyperoptimization, then you are at the right address on their site and GitHub. Before I continue with the rest of my explanation, you should know that if you have not installed the hyperopt libraries with the installation of FractTrade, you can always install these with the installation command, which reads a file containing all the necessary hyperopt libraries to install. Also, the Docker users do not have to do this because hyperopt libraries are installed in the Docker container by default. Now, let's start with the question, what is hyperparameter optimization? If you could describe the principle behind hyperparameter optimization or hyperopt from now on and keep this description as understandable as possible, then you could say that this is simply finding the best parameters for your indicators automatically and that can give you the best trading results while reducing risk. This means that the bot does the heavy work of backtesting your strategy every time using different parameters for your indicators and keeps score of the best possible combinations. Then, after a certain amount of tests, it shows you the results you can use for your strategy. The whole process of calculating these optimal indicator values and the best strategy results is much more complex behind the scenes because FractTrade makes use of data science principles and statistics. Also, the calculation of the strategy performance is based on well-known risk management principles. I will not go into these theoretical models in this video because there are many other videos and websites that can explain this way better than I could ever do. So, I recommend you to read up on these background principles and watch these videos to give you a feeling what's happening in the background when hyperopting. So, now you know what hyperopt does. It tries to find the best parameters for you in an automated way. Hyperopt can help you find the parameters for the following goals written on the sheet. The best parameters for your strategy for buy signals, and the same goes for sell signals. Also, hyperopt can help you by finding the best return on investment values. Hyperopt can help you also with finding the best stop loss and trailing stop loss values. And also hyperopt can help you by finding the best protection settings for your strategy. Now let's dive right into my first example. And in this case I make use of a simple RSI strategy where the RSI will give me buy signals and will give me sell signals. Also I want to make use of the best return on investment. So I want to know at which levels my bot has to sell and make a nice profit. And I also want to know the best stop loss value where my trade can still breathe before it goes up but will stop out when the price is dumping. In this case, hyperopt has to find four values. The optimal level for buy signals. So in this case, the RSI will be going down, but below a certain point, a buy signal has to be occurring. And hyperopt should also give me the level where the RSI should be above and give me a sell signal. The ROI table has to be filled by hyperopt with the most ideal settings. And finally, of course, the optimal stop loss value. And to repeat myself one more time, I can ask the hyperopt system to determine the best parameters for buy signals, sell signals, the best ROI settings, the best stop loss level, and of course more. But before we translate these questions into a hyperopt file, we first must understand some hyperopt concepts. The first concept you must understand is the hyperopt space. I also call this sometimes the search scope because hyperopt will search for the optimal parameter value in the scope you set in the strategy file. From now on, I will also call this the space. Each question I asked in the last slide has its own space. So, in this case, the RSI buy value should get its search space and the RSI cells value should get its search space. For the ROI space, FragTrade uses its own configured search space, which you can find on the website. This is also true for the stop-loss search space and trailing stop-loss space, so you don't have to worry about thinking of these search spaces. You only have to worry about the indicator spaces. Now in this example, I'm using the optimal RSI buy value that I'm searching. And as you can see in my chart, the best buy opportunities lie in the lower RSI value range. So in this case, I'm configuring the search space between RSI 5 and RSI 30, which means that I actually tell HyperOpt to search for the optimal RSI buy value between 5 and 30. This is also true for the sell value of the RSI indicator, and I will show you this later on. Now the first thing HyperOpt does to find the optimal value is randomly create 30 combinations of the indicator value within the given indicator space. HyperOpt does this every time you start a command. If you want, you can lock the initial state of these random values with the initial state command line parameter so that you can create reproducible results if you like. Then the best results from that random search are used for the next stage. In that stage, Bayesian search theory with some extra algorithms will be used to search for the best possible combinations. I do not go much deeper into the theory of Bayesian search and the regressor algorithm that are used because that's way out of scope for this video. But I can tell you that these kinds of search mechanisms and decision tree algorithms are also used when finding lost objects like sea vessels or in machine learning. You can check Wikipedia if you want. I'm not an expert in these fields, but then again, you don't have to know how a car works to actually drive one. So now let's move on with the next concepts we have to be aware of. These concepts we have to know before we actually can go and define our first HyperOpt file are guards and triggers. A guard is like a boundary for your strategy. Across this boundary, the bot is not allowed to do something. And a trigger is the moment where the bot is actually acting on a signal. Now I have a question for you. Is this a guard or a trigger? Actually, technically, there is no difference between a guard and a trigger. In this case, the guard for buying is the value after the lesser than symbol. When RSI is above this guard value, there is no buying allowed. But when RSI actually crosses down this value, that event is a trigger for the bot to buy the asset. So in other words, as long as the RSI is above the guard, there is no trigger. But the event of RSI crossing below the guard is the trigger to actually buy the asset. In my RSI strategy, I could say that my guard is maybe the 30 level before I buy something and maybe 80 before I sell something. Now, how do I translate this into a HyperOpt file? First, I have to define the search space for the indicator parameters. I can do this by using these lines in my HyperOpt file, and I will show you this later. You can see that each search space begins with a start value for the space and an end value for the space, and also a default value. And you can also define to which space a parameter belongs. There is one other thing that I should mention before I continue, and that's the parameter type to use. In this example, taken from the FragTrade site, there are multiple types of parameters shown. There are 5 types of parameters which can be roughly separated in number parameters and choice parameters. So here are the numbers and here are the choices. The integer parameter uses whole numbers for your space, so in this case 21, 22, 23, 24 and so on. The decimal parameter uses floating point numbers, so 21.1, 21.2, 21.3, and it limits the amount of decimals behind the point to 3. So you'll get a precise value up to 3 decimals behind the whole number. This way the amount of numbers to calculate stays manageable. The real parameter also uses floating point numbers but has no precision limit, so the amount of possible numbers within the space can be almost infinite and calculations can take a long time. The question remains if you want to have your strategy parameter so precisely defined, and therefore I think it's nice to have this option, but there are hardly any cases when you want to actually use this. The categorical parameters give you the opportunity to use a predefined number of choices. Here you can think of true-false combinations, or you can also give HyperOpt the possibility to choose between different indicators in search for the best parameter for your strategy. And you can see this over here, the choice between Bollinger Band or MACD. And finally, the Boolean parameter can also be used for true-false choices. The usage of these parameter types is dependent on the indicator space you want to use. but also if you want to let HyperOp determine if the strategy is more successful with or without a parameter, with a true-false Boolean. You can also even let HyperOp do a comparison between multiple parameters, as I said before, and let it determine if one indicator performs better than the other. And I've shown you that it was a choice between Bollinger Band or the MACD cross signal. Now, to get back to the HyperOpt file creation. For this strategy, we try to find the value that the RSI indicator should cross to get a signal for buying or selling. In this case, we can just use the default code for creating an indicator for the strategy file. You can also use HyperOpt to also search for the optimal indicator value, which in this case is the time period. But for this example, we only search for the value that the RSI 14 has to cross for a signal. The last thing we have to do is write a buy strategy and a sell strategy for the buy and sell function. In the RSI example, we are telling the buy strategy to buy when the RSI value is lower than the buy RSI parameter value, which lies somewhere in the search space that we have defined earlier. HyperOpt will now iterate through the populate buy trend many times, which are called epochs, with different value combinations. These conditions will be added to a list, and then the reduce function will be applied to the list. The reduce function will reduce or fold all list items that are found by the HyperOpt to a single value or statement. If this value or statement says that RSI is lower than the found parameter value, then a buy signal is given, which is shown here. Based on the results, HyperOpt will tell you which parameter combination produces the best results, which are based on the configured loss function in the command, which I will tell you more later in this video. And the same thing goes with the sell strategy, of course. Here you will see all the values entered in the function from the search space, and then it will be added to the reduce function to get the final best results. Now that I have shown you the sections for this simple strategy HyperOpt file, it is time to show you how to execute the optimization from the command line. Be sure that you also have enough backtesting data downloaded for testing and that this data matches the time frame of your strategy. There are also multiple HyperOpt command line options, and I will go over some of them a little later. Now let's backtest with the HyperOpt function. For this demonstration, I have opened a file explorer, my terminal window, and my GitHub site, which contains all the repositories for all the videos I've made earlier. Let's open the site, the GitHub repository for this video. And you can see over here all the files that I've made earlier in preparation for this video. Now let's create a new HyperOpt file that I've prepared earlier. And this contains all the necessary programming rules, but it doesn't contain the actual HyperOpt parts. Now let's put it to the side and let's open my prepared file for the RSI strategy. And this file contains all the settings that I've shown you earlier in the presentation. So it's just a matter of copying and pasting. I'll make this a raw file, which copies a little bit easier for me. You can see over here the defined spaces for the indicators. So for the buy RSI indicator, I've said that HyperOp should search for values between 5 and 30. And for the sell RSI, it should search for 75 and 95. So it's just a matter of copying and pasting in this manner. And I put this in the defined spaces section of this file. Okay. Now let's configure the RSI parameter itself, the RSI indicator I mean, and I put this in the function for the populate indicator section. Okay, now that I have configured the space to search in and the RSI indicator, it's time to configure the buy trend and the sell trend settings. And these are actually the guards and triggers that FragTrade uses for the HyperOpt. Let's just copy this whole section and place it in the actual file. And I'm also going to copy this whole section and place it in the sell trend section. Okay, what will happen next is that each time FragTrade HyperOpt will run an epoch or backtrade, it randomly takes a buy RSI parameter and sell RSI parameter and places this in the self buy RSI value and self sell RSI value. Then FragTrade backtests these parameters over the downloaded backtest data and determines if this produced better results or worse results than the previous epoch. If it's worse, then FragTrade goes over this process again, but if it's better, then these results will be put into the results table. And finally, the best results will be shown with the companioning parameter values. Let's save this and start the HyperOps session. Okay, this is saved, so I can close this, close this, close this, and make this bigger. The FragTrade HyperOpt command is as follows. FragTrade HyperOpt, and then take the config file. Then take the strategy file, which is RSI strat. Then we determine the amount of epochs to run. So that's the amount of backtests we will run. And in my case, I will only run 50 epochs. But under normal circumstances, you would at least run 500 epochs. So this is only for demonstration purposes. Now I will determine the spaces I want to test. And these determine the buy space, sell space, the ROI space, stop loss space, trailing stop loss space to test. So spaces is default in this case. And the last thing I want to do is determining which HyperOpt loss function I want to use. In this case, I want to use the sharp HyperOpt loss. HyperOpt. And this will be the sharp HyperOpt loss. Okay, I think I typed this command correctly, so let's start and run this command. And you can see HyperOpt is now backtesting with some values that it randomly gets from the search space. And you can see that each time a new line is added to the table, then it finds a better strategy parameter. Now I've made a screen print of an earlier HyperOpt session, so I can tell you what this all means. These asterisks you see in the first columns indicate that these were the initial random searches or epochs within the search space defined. These are the epochs tested, and each new epoch produced better results. And these are the actual trades each epoch did and which results it gave. And this is the information about the drawdown from the highest profit point. You want to keep this as low as possible, so you don't give back your gains to the market. You can see that the last epoch here produced good results, because only 3% drawdown has occurred. And this is the actual object that we want to achieve. This number should be as low as possible, and I come back to this a little bit later on the video, because it's the most important number. This number is the random state number, and this number changes every time you execute a HyperOpt session. This number determines the randomization of the search for optimal parameters. This means also that every time you perform a HyperOpt session, you'll probably get different results because of this random state number. However, you can set this random state number also in a command line option to repeat the set of initial random epochs. This way, the HyperOpt session always uses the same random numbers, and you can repeat the exact same test over and over again. But then it's not random anymore, of course. What I can do with this random state number in my command line is that I can now change the RSI 14 to another number, let's say RSI 7 or RSI 21, and keep the same epochs to test if my backtest results get better or not. And finally, what I've told you earlier, in this example, the predefined ROI settings to find the best ROI results in the HyperOpt session. You can also see these settings on the HyperOpt page of the FragTrade site. And you can also change this to your own likings, but that's more of an advanced HyperOpt setting. Now this screen shows the results of the HyperOpt session, and these configuration recommendations gave the best results. This is the epoch with the best results, and most of the time it's the last one. This is the value of the RSI guard, where the RSI should get below to trigger a buy signal. This is the value of the RSI guard, where the RSI should get above to trigger a sell signal. These are the ROI settings which produce the best results. And finally, this is a stop loss limit that gives the trade enough room to breathe, but will trigger a sell when the price goes lower than this. What you can do to check these settings is to enter them in your strategy file and then do a manual backtest. And if that manual backtest produces the same results as the high-prop session, then the strategy is good. So let's continue and create a strategy file with all these parameters. To open the File Explorer, I already prepared an empty strategy file. And I just can copy it to my strategies folder. And before I forget, these parameters are also saved in a JSON file. So if you lost these results in the terminal window, you could always look back in this file. Okay, but let's just create the strategy. And let's start from the front. This is the RSI strategy file. And we should also take care of the 1 day time frame. And here I can see the minimal ROI is 0.99, which is not correct, of course. You know what? I will do this. Put this over here. Put this over here. And I will just copy and paste this one to here. And let's see, indentation looks fine also. The stop loss is 0.16, so it's just a matter of replacing the 0 with a 6. I did not use the trailing stop loss, so this stays false. But what I have to do is create an indicator, that was the RSI indicator, which is over here. This stays the same. And what I also have to do is create two data frame columns with the RSI settings for the buy and sell values. And you can create them like this. Just enter data frame. I'm not sure if the indentation is correct. I think it's not. Now it's correct. So let's start over again. And this is the buy RSI level. And that's equal of 30. And let's copy and paste this. And this will be 90. So let's change this to sell RSI. Okay, that's the first part. And now what I have to do is populate the buy and sell trends. And here I only have to compare the RSI data frame column, which I can put over here, and say if it's lesser than the buy RSI, and here the RSI should be higher than the sell RSI. So this here, and now we have populated the buy and sell strategy, and let's see what will happen if I backtest this strategy file and see if this compares to the results of my high-propped, and it was these ones. So yeah, let's do this. Fract rate, back test, and then take the config file. And take the strategy file. And in this case, I have called the strategy file my new strategy. Let's check if the name also is in the function here. You see, my new strategy. Whoops. Save this. My new strategy. And let's see what the results are. Now let's remember this: total profit 738, and the absolute profit was 73.8. And if I compare this to these final epoch results, then these are the same results. So the strategy file is the same, has the same results, I mean. And then we can say that this strategy file can be used for forward testing, also called dry running. And if the dry run also succeeds, then we can use this as an actual strategy file for our live trading. Okay, this ends the first demonstration of HyperOpt, and let's continue with the presentation. Earlier, I talked about the objective in the results table. And as said, this objective or loss function is very important because this function determines which parameters perform the best and therefore determine the settings you could put in your strategy. The different loss functions calculate the trade returns on different standard deviations, and it's for you to decide which loss function to use. It depends not only on your preferred strategy, but also on your time frame, the point you want to calculate your loss from, and more. For example, the Sharpe ratio is the ratio which is often used by traders, and it can give you information about the return on investment by your strategy compared to its risk. Please do your own research on the types of loss functions and which you want to use when deciding the best strategy parameters though. The generic rule for each loss function is the lower the score, the better the performance. So to show you a comparison between the different loss functions, here are some HyperOpt best result comparisons on a limited dataset between the ratios of the different loss functions. Each HyperOpt command uses the same random state to keep the epochs the same. You see that each loss function has different results. This is mostly due to the fact that the ROI table is different for each loss function result. For now, I leave it at this, but again, I recommend you to do your own research on these loss functions. Here is an overview of other command line options you should know. The first command line option is the spaces option. This option lets you determine if you want to test a specified space. You can choose default, and then HyperOpt will search all spaces except trailing and protection space. But you can also search only in the buy space, or only in the sell space, ROI space, stop loss space, etc. By narrowing the search to a specific space, you gain some time, because the test will only search the specified space. As an example, you can also specify to search the buy and sell space at the same time. The epoch setting is used to define the number of epochs to run. Or in other words, here you set the amount of backtests to run by the HyperOpt function. You can check if a HyperOpt strategy file is working by first using a small number of epochs. And when the HyperOpt file works, you can then set a large number of epochs to find optimal strategy parameters. The job workers parameter is used to determine how many processors you want to burn while hyperopting. By default, all processors are used, but if you use the -2 option, for example, you tell hyperopt to use one processor less for the test. The random state is the number that is used to produce the first 30 random numbers for testing, and I've shown you this earlier in an example. With the minimum trades parameter, you tell hyperopt to evaluate a result only if a certain number of trades is made. Results with lesser trades are not evaluated, so you have a certain boundary. And finally, the time range parameter is used to test over a specific time period. So if you have 3 years of backtesting data and you only want to test the last year, you can set it over here. And again, you can read the FragTrade site for more parameters you can use. Now let's move on with our second and slightly more difficult example for this video. In this second example, I want to know which simple moving averages I have to use for a crossover for buying and which SMAs I have to use for the best exit signal. So for this strategy, I will make use of two SMA crossover pairs. In this example, my hypothesis looked like this. Using an SMA crossover strategy, which SMA crossover parameters provide the best buy signals and which provide the best sell signals? And what performance can I expect from those parameters? Now I have to think about the next things. The indicators to use, which is simple of course because there are two pairs of simple moving averages. But I also have to think about the search spaces where the SMAs will be living in. In my example, I will keep the search space between 5 and 50. So I potentially have 55 SMAs times 2 and this times 2 to test. Then I will have to populate the indicator function so that the indicators use the values given by the randomization function. And then I have to program the buy and sell trend. And finally, if I have programmed everything correctly, then I start the hyperopt function. For the second demonstration, I'm also going to use this pre-configured hyperopt file. It's a template, as I earlier said. And this time I'm going to copy it. And I'm going to rename it to SMA cross strat. Open it. And you can see it's empty. Well, it's not empty. It contains the bare necessities for a hyperopt file. And I'm going to use this file which I have created earlier. And I'm going to do the same procedure as the RSI strategy, hyperopt. First, we have to determine the buy and sell space. And because we have two simple moving averages for buying and for selling, we have to create four lines in our strategy. I'm just going to simply copy and paste this to my file. And what this says is we have a buy space which contains two moving averages, and those spaces are between 5 and 60, so SMA 5 and 60 for the quick and slow SMA. And we also want to have this same space for the sell SMAs. Now, a little bit more complex is this section, because instead of a hard value, which is a line for the RSI that to cross, we are going to create some functions. And we're going to populate the indicators over here. And for each epoch, there will be four random values created for each space. So the quick SMA for buying gets a random value, the buy slow EMA gets a random value, and so on. And each value will be passed in this function, where it will create a data frame column with the value, and it will create a simple moving average with a time period of that value. So every time an epoch is run, it will create four random moving averages, which will be used in the buy and sell trends. Now let's enter those ones as well, and I'm going to take this complete section, the complete function, and I was just simply copying and pasting it in this section, so not to create any typos. And I'll do this with the sell function as well. Let me check. Okay, this looks good. Now, to explain what's happening over here, is that for each simple moving average, there will be a crossover condition created, which says that the quick SMA value, or the quick moving average, should be crossing above the slow moving average. If this is the case, there will be an event, and that event creates a buy condition. And the same goes for the sell trend population. Every time random simple moving averages are created, they will be populated in this function. And this is the quick, and this is a slow simple moving average for selling. And every time the quick simple moving averages crosses below the slow moving average, it will create a sell condition. So there you have it. Let's save this and go over to my terminal and enter the command to test this hyperoptimization. And there's one thing I forgot. I have to rename this strategy. Otherwise, it will give me an error. Where's the name? It should be SMA cross strat. Okay. Let's go ahead and enter the command for hyperopting. SMA. And I will do 50 epochs again. And I am going to use the default spaces. And this time I'm going to use a random state I used earlier to check if I get the same results. And I also want to see only the results with a minimum amount of trades of 10. And finally, I want to use the sharp hyperopt loss. Let's check. Okay, I think everything looks fine. Now let's enter and see what will happen. Okay, well, as you can see, it gave me some results. I see I get 21% profit at least from this strategy. The drawdown is ok at a minimum, so let's continue with the presentation. In my case, I've got these results. This means that my buy crossover pair is the 15 and 14 SMA. And for my sell signal, I have to use the SMA 11 and SMA 48. Also, the ROI table is shown over here, and my stop loss will be 0.23. And over to the backtest data, which has given me a potential gain of 21% and with a drawdown of less than 1%, which is very good, I think. But anyway, this is an example, and your strategy might be different and should give different results as well. If I enter the proposed values in my charting tool, then you can see that the buy SMAs are these ones. And you can see here that these are the buy signals. And if I chart the sell signal SMAs, then you can see that the sell signals are over here. So you can see these are the potential gains this strategy has given me. But this strategy is only for demonstration purposes, and I would not recommend you to use this in actual trading. Besides, it's also tested on a limited dataset and limited epochs. So if I backtested this strategy on a larger dataset and with a larger amount of epochs, then it would probably give me other results. Now, for my final demonstration, I'm going to use the example from the FragTrade site, which is the solving a mystery section. Based on my backtesting dataset, I'm going to determine if the lower Bollinger Bands or the MACD gives me the best buy indicator. And I'm also going to determine if the ADX or RSI indicators help me with getting the best results. And finally, I want to know which ROI settings are the most profitable. So let's begin and enter these settings in my file. The procedure is as follows. Based on the case given and the parameters given, we have to determine the spaces where to find the optimal parameters in. Then we have to configure the indicators in the hyperopt file. We have to populate the buy and trend function. And there's no sell trend given, so the hyperopt command will only search in the spaces buy and ROI. So let's clean this up. And get the other one. And I'm going to get the example from the FragTrade site. Let's see. Yes. I can remove this one. And I'm going to create a new hyperopt, and I'm going to call it Awesome Strategy. Open the file. Rename it before I forget. Let's save it just in case. And now this time I'm first going to populate the search spaces. So in this case, of all the indicators that FragTrade has given me here. And the next thing, I'm going to populate the indicators, which are here. Just going to copy this section. And this looks good too. And the final thing we have to do is populate the buy trend, which is over here. It's very easy, just copying and pasting. So now that this is copied and pasted, we can enter the command to start hyper-optimizing and see if the MACD or Bollinger Band is giving me a trigger signal, and if ADX or RSI give me better results, and if so, with which values. So let's go ahead and enter the command. So it's FragTrade hyperopt, and then use the config file. And then define the strategy. And next, I'm going to define the amount of epochs to use, which is 50. And which spaces to investigate. And in this case, because the strategy did not have a sell strategy, I will only search for optimal buy or ROI settings. Spaces, buy, and ROI. And now finally, my hyperopt loss function, which is the short trade duration hyperopt loss function for a change. So hyperopt loss, and then short trade duration hyperopt loss. Hopefully I entered the command correctly. Let's see. Okay. Now let's see what will happen and which results I get. Okay, now let's see the results. I have an average profit of 3% and total profit of 12%, but my drawdown is 91, so I guess this is not a very good strategy. But what's more important is, did we find out which trigger or which indicator triggered the buy signal? And in this case, it was the Bollinger Band lower indicator that triggered the buy signal. And also, if I see this, I can see that the buy ADX enabled is advised to be false. So this hyperopt session said that ADX was not recommended to use. And also that RSI is not recommended to be used. And finally, you can see here the ROI table, which gives me the recommended parameter settings for optimal results when trading. Okay, let's finish this demonstration and go ahead with our video. One huge danger of trying to get the best results from backtesting data is the problem of curve fitting. Here you tweak your strategy parameters in such a way that you create maximum theoretical profits from past market data. However, what the market did in the past is not guaranteed to also happen in the future. So also the parameters you found and performed so well in the past are not guaranteed to also work optimal in the future. You should always stay aware of this if you use the advised parameters from the hyperopt function. And you should always keep a close eye on the market and your strategy under life circumstances and take action if you notice that the strategy is not working as intended. And with this said, I'm going to end this video. If you like the contents of this video and you think it's worth your time, then please click the like button to let me know. Also, please subscribe to my channel and click the notification bell to get updated on new videos. It certainly helps me to give positive feedback because I put a lot of effort and time in these videos to give you valuable content. I hope to see you soon in my next video. Goodbye.